is in Christ alone. I wish I could be here to hear everyone sing this one. This is one that everyone always sings from the heart, and it's just so great to hear the congregation sing along. I wish I could be there with you guys. But I will imagine in my heart and in my ears that you guys are there singing with me. But let's sing In Christ Alone. Sing, turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Look full in his wonderful face.
Next song is Jesus, Thank You. Perfect.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to Quail Lake Church Online. It's great to have you with us, and we've been working through the book of James. We've done the first two chapters. We're on chapter 3, and if you want to stop and go grab your Bible, it might be good because we've got some scriptures for you that are going to be pretty important today. But I tell you what, let's start with a word of prayer, and we'll jump into this one, which we are calling Taming the Wild Beast. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. You're a great and awesome God, and we pray now that as we come before you, that you would teach us, inspire us, encourage us, but draw us close to you. Father, we want to be able to love you and know you and experience you, all of those things. And Father, we pray that you will use your word today in that way. I pray for all those who are watching, and Father, ask that wherever they are, whatever they're doing, whatever they're going through, that God, they'll be assured that you know. You know what's happening, and you know their lives, their dreams, all the things, the needs they have, and you're the God who's going to take care of them. Thank you for that. And now we just ask that you'll speak to us, and we pray it in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Well, it's called Taming the Wild Beast. And if you remember from last time we were here, we heard James tell us that our words are important, that it's important what we say, but he says the proof of what we believe is how we live. You know, he says, you know, you can tell me about your faith and all of that and declare it, but he says, I want to see it. I want to see your faith lived out. And so we live as followers of this Jesus, the Bible, and you know, we talk about the words, and we find that those words we speak, they have real power to them. And we can do some wonderful things with our words. We can inspire or heal or educate, but those words can also deceive or destroy or discourage. And one of the things about our words is that once they're spoken, they can never be taken back. So it's important on what we say as well as, you know, the things that we do. Because those words can be apologized for, they can be forgiven, but they never can be erased from our memory. So James is going to address that today, the tongue, the things we say. And it starts off this way. We're going to label this one offending others. But it begins like this. Dear brothers and sisters, not many of you should become teachers in the church, for we who teach will be judged more strictly. Indeed, we all make many mistakes, for if we could control our tongues, we'd be perfect and could also control ourselves in every other way. We can make a large horse go wherever we want by means of a small bit in his mouth. And a small rudder makes a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go, even though the winds are strong. Now, James starts off this whole thing, and he's going to be talking about our speech. He says our tongue, but he's talking about our words, about being careful with speech by going to teachers first. And he says, you know, you need to be careful. He says, don't jump into that teaching in the church, because he says, if you teach, you need to understand something, you're going to be judged more strictly. And the first thing you must think of, because I think of it every time I read this, is that I'm going to be judged by God if I don't tell the truth. You know, I need to say what God has told us, and that's true. It's certainly true. So to teach really in any setting is a high calling. And the reason for that is when you teach, it demands a trust relationship between the speaker and the hearer. And so people are often trusting, but he says, you know, they got to be discerning in the midst of that too. And that's why I say here that, you know, whenever you listen to somebody, including me, question it. Question everything. Because, you know what, teachers make mistakes. And too often they're swayed by the culture. Sometimes by money, by powerful people. And so It's not just in the church. It happens everywhere. But here he's talking about the church, and this, the one side of the warning is that we're going to compromise or misuse Scripture for personal use. Now, I had an example of that given to me when I was in seminary, and I had this wonderful, he was an older guy, he was an older Mennonite preacher, and and he came and he was teaching us homiletics, which is the art and the practice of preaching. And he said, you guys need to be careful about how you're using the Scripture. And he said, I want to give you an example of somebody who misused it. And the story goes, there was an old Mennonite minister, and this preacher was there, and he was disturbed about something that was happening in his congregation and in his church. And so the ladies, typically in this church and in this culture and time, this was a long time ago, they just had their hair free-flowing and such. And it would flow down to their shoulders or on their back or whatever. But there became a new fashion among women, and some of the younger ladies especially began to do something different. They would shape their hair on top of their heads, maybe like a bun or something else. And it was just kind of the thing that women were doing. But they called it a top knot. And so these young ladies were doing the top knots. Well, the pastor was just beside himself that these young women were doing this, and it felt like it was going to have some dire consequences in the church. So he decided to look for a scripture that he could use to correct this poor choice that these women were making and putting their hair in this top knot. And what he wanted to do was get them to return to what he and probably others felt was a more godly kind of perspective. And sure enough, he found the scripture. It goes like this. This is from the King James Version, and it's from Mark 13. And let him that is on the housetop not go down to the house, neither therein to take anything out of his house. Did you catch that? What he was going to use? Here was the scripture that he took out of that he used for his message that day. Now, you need to go back and take a look at it to be able to get this. The scripture he read that day was, top knot, go down. That was it. That was it. He used the scriptures the wrong way for the wrong reason. And you might say, well, it does say top knot ought to go down. No. That's why we need to put scripture in context, when it was delivered and how it's meant to be used, all of that. And that's one of the ways that teachers in the church are going to be judged. Did you use the scripture rightly? And all of us will be judged because of things that we wish we hadn't said, or wish we had said, you know, or maybe we said them in the wrong way. But there's another judgment that comes on. It says you're going to be judged more strictly. It's not only by God himself, but this one is going to be by people as well in this. And it goes the other way. Now, I'm going to take a topic that's a hot topic in our society, and that's homosexuality. And one of the things that people struggle with in our society is, you know, the whole issue of we have people who are gay and so forth, and you know, so what do we do on that? What does the Bible say about that? Well, I was doing a workout on my bike, and I was watching a show that I like called Blue Bloods, and I like it because it has two actors in it, Tom Selleck from Magnum P.I. and then Donnie Wahlberg from Band of Brothers. And they had this scene where Tom Selleck, who is the New York Police Department police commissioner, and he's a devout Catholic Christian in this show. And so he's asked in a press conference about an incident involving a gay police officer who gets kind of outed in something that happens. And one of the reporters, they have it set up in this scene where he asks Tom Selleck and says, now, he says, Commissioner, how do you deal with this whole situation being a member of the Catholic Church and their hatred for gay people? And I thought, wait a minute. That scene that they created for the TV show, wait, that's not right. That's not what's going on. And then I thought, you know, the people might say that about me too. That, well, wait a minute. All I'm doing is taking a look at what the Bible says and sharing that with people. And you know, when I do that, people get offended. And I'm judged by that. But I need to say, you know, your problem isn't with me. It's you and the Bible. You don't like the Bible. And beyond that, I don't think you like the God who gave us the Bible either. And what you're doing is you're judging me because I'm telling you what the Bible says and agreeing with what the Bible says. So you need to understand that that cuts two ways. That God will judge you, not God, people will judge you for telling them what God has said. And so that's why, you know, when you look through the Old Testament, you'll see a record of one prophet after another being persecuted because they told people what God wanted them to hear, not what they wanted to hear. Now, on the other side of this, if as a teacher in the church we choose to teach what God has said and then change it for approval's sake, then we have a God who says, hey, cowboy or cowgirl, I trusted you to speak for me. That was the deal, and you reneged on the deal, and you didn't tell the truth. And then it's judgment from God. Okay, that's just verse one out of all this. Can you imagine where we're headed? Well, hang on. James tells us in the next three verses that the tongue is a dangerous thing. He says, first, we all make mistakes. We are all sinners. And I'm still shocked by people who say that, well, I've come to Christ, and, you know, now I'm not really capable of sin. And I've had people tell me that. I thought, oh, my goodness, wow, you ought to be up here instead of me because I still make all kinds of mistakes, all kinds of stuff. And that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says you're going to still struggle. You're still going to commit sin again and again. Because if we can control that tongue of ours, he says, you'd be pretty well on your way to being perfect. And when it talks about being perfect here, it means complete. You've finished the course. You got it done. There's nothing left to do here. If you could completely control that tongue, he says, you could control every other part of you. But you don't. And I don't. And the reason we don't is because we can't. And that's the next time. Next thing we have here is we need to be the lion tamer. In verse 5, in the same way, the tongue is a small thing that makes many grand speeches. But a tiny spark can set a great forest on fire. And among all the parts of the body, the tongue is a flame of fire. It's a whole world of wickedness corrupting your entire body. It can set your whole life on fire, for it is set on fire by hell itself. People can tame all kinds of animals and birds and reptiles and fish, but no one can tame the tongue. It's restless and evil, full of deadly poison. Sometimes it praises our Lord and Father, and sometimes it curses those who have been made in the image of God. And so blessing and cursing come pouring out of the same mouth. Surely, my brothers and sisters, this is not right. Does a spring of water bubble out with both fresh water and bitter water? Does a fig tree produce olives or a grapevine produce figs? No. You can't draw fresh water from a salty spring. But we're going to stop there because, you see, James is not pulling any punches in this whole thing. If you're looking for some soft and sweet affirmation, go somewhere else in the Bible. He's giving us some raw truth here. And this guy is hitting humankind hard with the truth. And he says, you know, like little things that control big things, the tongue is a little thing that can make all kinds of great sounding speeches. You know, that tongue, that little tongue, he says, it can do powerful things. It can, like a little spark, it can start a forest fire. And we well know that here with the Sierra Nevada right up above us where we are here. All summer long, we look and we can see smoke coming up, and, you know, usually there are big fires that rage up there. And James warns us our tongues are like a flame of fire, not just a spark. And he says it can corrupt your life and destroy you just like you're destroying others. It can burn your life down around you. And then he hits us with the source of all of this. He says it's the tongue. The tongue. When it's on track to destroy everything around it, it's set on fire by hell itself. And that's where all this comes from. And remember, James is writing this 2,000 years ago, and he's saying you could look all around you and people even today. And he says, you know what? we can tame all kind of animals, all kinds of them. 2,000 years ago, we can tame birds and reptiles and fish, all these wild things. He says, we can control them. We can do it. We do it all the time. But he says, you know what? We can't tame the tongue. No one can do it, he says. Now listen to how he describes the tongue. First is restless. It just can't stop. It's always on the prowl to see what it can do next. You got to watch it all the time. And then he says, it's evil. It hurts people. You know, it's not loving all the time like we ought to be. Even with people we disagree with or, you know, or whatever it might be. No, we still show the love of Jesus. And what James says here, he says, you know, it's depraved. It's damaging. And he's not done yet. And he says, that tongue is full of deadly poison. So this is a dangerous thing. But then he gets really illustrative here. And he says, you know, that tongue of yours, it'll praise God and then turn around and curse those made in the image of God. He says, you can't do that. You're not supposed to do that. It blesses and then it turns around and curses. We're not supposed to do it. He says, you can't do both things. You know, if you come to a spring and you grab some water, you don't taste both fresh and bitter and say, hey, this part tastes fresh and this one's bitter. No. What do you get? Bitter water. That's all you get. And James tells us that we cannot bring something out of us that isn't in us. He says, you know what? You can fake it for a while. And you can deceive people for a while. But sooner or later, it comes out. And he talks about a fig tree with olives. He said, that fig tree is never going to produce olives. That Thompson grapevine, he says, you're never going to find figs growing there either. And so James is letting us know where the real problem is. It isn't the tongue in your mouth that's a real issue. What it's doing is simply opening the door for all of us to see what's inside our hearts. And sooner or later, that mask that we wear every day gets removed and we get to see who we really are. And sometimes people get to see who we really are too. And he closes with, he says, you know, you can't draw fresh water from a salty spring. You know, it's just not going to happen. I like to boogie board over at the coast and go over there. I'm not a surfer, but I can do boogie boarding, and I'm at best, I'm okay on this. And because I'm just okay, I end up taking some pretty good tumbles in that surf. And I've gulped down a lot of that Pacific Ocean. And you know what? I am never, ever surprised whenever I get a mouthful of Pacific Ocean that it's salty. You know, I don't go, oh my goodness, I was expecting fresh water. No, this is salt water here. That's all I'm going to get out of this place. I'm not surprised because I know the ocean, at least well enough, and that's all I'm going to get. And James says, you know what? That's what we're going to get out of our tongue when it's not controlled, when it doesn't give us kindness and love and bring peace and gentleness, even to people we disagree with, who we live differently from. And then James leads us to what we need to know. Where all this comes from. And here's what fuels the tongue. Verse 13, if you're wise in understanding God's ways, prove it by living an honorable life, doing good works with the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you're bitterly jealous and there's selfish ambition in your heart, don't cover up the truth with boasting and lying. For jealousy and selfishness are not God's kind of wisdom. Such things are earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. For wherever there's jealousy and selfish ambition, there you'll find disorder and evil of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first of all pure. It is also peace-loving, gentle at all times, and willing to yield to others. It's full of mercy and the fruit of good deeds. It shows no favoritism and is always sincere. And those who are peacemakers will plant seeds of peace and reap a harvest of righteousness. Now, if we journey back to last week when we were looking at chapter 2, James was reminding us that we can talk about our faith all the time. But he said, you know, what you do out there really demonstrates what we believe in our hearts. And if you go all the way back to the beginning of this incredible letter, or some people call it an essay, he said, we should welcome trials because the hard times and the experiences that put pressure on our faith, the faith that we proclaim, we begin to find out what we really believe. What do we believe? Because literally what's happening to you is you're being stress tested. Can my faith take it? But the other thing is that the more your faith is tested, the stronger it becomes and the more it can take. So when you're getting hit with things that rock your world and wonder why God didn't give you a pass, remember first, he's not bringing bad things into your world. The evil one does that. But he will allow you to be stress tested so that you'll be able to stand firm in your faith. And now he tells us, well, if you're wise and you know so much about God that you need to teach everybody around you, you finally understand God's ways, you know what God's doing in those hard times, then prove it to us. Prove it. And he says, do this. Live an honorable life. What does that mean? To be worthy, noble. Be righteous, moral, praiseworthy. Live that way. And you live that way by doing good works with the humility that comes from wisdom. But he says, if there's any kind of bitterness or jealousy or self-serving ambition in your heart, and you say, well, what would that look like? Well, he's talking about somebody who has a critical, contentious, even fight-provoking way of dealing with people. He says, don't try to mask it with boasting or lying. He says, some people take pride in being that kind of tough person, you know. You know, I'm a no-nonsense, taking no prisoner kind of an individual. No, you know what that is? That's being a jerk. Don't do that. And the reason is, we all see it, and God sees it. Jealousy and selfishness, they're not from God. And James says, and he doesn't pull any punches here. And he says, you know, you got to remember this, gang. This stuff, what does it mean? And he says, you have only this life in view. And he said, this life is not going to last. This is not heaven. And the object here, when he says, you know, your attitude is not heavenly, is that it's only gratification for my passions now. What makes me feel good about me? That's what I'm focused on. And he says, no, this doesn't come from God. It comes from the elsewhere, the demonic. And that means the inspiration comes from the minions of Satan. So he reminds us of something that we all probably can see in our own experiences with people, that when stuff is out there, you know, this kind of stuff, all you get is disorder. You get evil of every kind. And that's the kind of stuff that's out there, and we're going to have to deal with it. For kids, you're going to see that. You see it at school. You see it demonstrated by your classmates. For you who are dealing with people at work or in the general business of life, you'll see it too. And here's the thing that you and I have to come to grips with. If you're not like that, if you're not doing that, it's only by the grace of God. See, it doesn't matter who you are, what you've done, what you're doing now. We're all in the same boat. We're all in the same boat. It's God's grace that we're looking for. God's grace that brings us something new. Now look what God's wisdom is like. He says, if you got God's wisdom, this is what it's going to look like. Pure. Absence of any sinful attitude or motive. Peace-loving. Mild. Calm. Kind to people. Kind to people you don't even like. Gentle. You know that word gentle? We have a hard time, they said, translating that. We don't really get the full impact of it. But they said maybe the best way to describe this gentleness is sweet reasonableness, patience, to be reasonable and sweet at the same time. Willing to yield, not to be stubborn or adamant, things that don't matter. Full of mercy and the fruit of good deeds. It's a forgiving spirit. It isn't just about talk. It's about how you treat people. It shows no favoritism. It's not partial to some and then seeking out the faults and the failures of others. It's not hypocritical. It's not phony or fake. Looking for what will make God look good, what will honor him. And those who do these things, he says, will come in peace. And that peace will come to the world around them. And he says, if you do this, you're going to plant seeds of peace wherever you go. And the crop that will come from living and working, the work that you do, will be righteousness. righteousness in the lives of men and women and boys and girls. And if you could be that peacemaker, he said, with your tongue, he says, you'll be given a special title. Did you know that? It's in Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. It's blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Now, we come to Christ, we're children of God. But he says, you're going to be called that. That's your title now that we're going to address you by. That's what God wants for us. So what do we do with all this stuff? How do we handle that? Well, three things I want to bring to you. First one is, in our own power, we can't control our tongues. Words have power. And you know what? They don't go away. And we need to remember, you know, those words stay forever. And then they can hurt and crush people. And you say, yeah, I want to do it. No, there isn't anybody out there you're supposed to crush with your words. There was a pastor who was counseling a person who was having trouble with their speech. A lot of it was gossip, but it was just mean stuff that they were saying about people. The problem was the person didn't understand the damage and the long-term harm that they were causing. And so he brought the person out. And he said, I want to meet with you. I want to talk with you about something. So a guy came over and such. And they got talking. And the pastor had a pillow. And he had a pair of scissors. He gave the guy a pillow. And he says, I want you to cut the end of the pillow off. It was a feather pillow. So he did. It was a real windy day. He picked a windy day. And they're out there in the street. And he said, okay, notice what's happening. And the feathers were starting to blow out of the pillow. He says, now shake the pillow. And he shook it. And the feathers went everywhere. I mean, they were all over the place, and just keep shaking it. He shook it and shook it. Finally, every feather was gone and such. And they watched. They were just carried down the street that way and such. And they watched in silence, and finally the pastor said, now I have one more thing I want you to do. The guy says, well, what? I want you to take that pillowcase and go and collect every feather out there now. He said, are you crazy? Nobody can do that. There's no way I could ever find those feathers. The pastor smiled and said, you're right. You're absolutely right. You'll never be able to get them back again. And he says, so it is with your words. Whatever you say will be out there forever and will touch hearts of people that you will never meet. So make sure what you say is something that you want to live out there forever. That's hard to do. It's hard to do. And part of it is so much because of what we do in our life is we lie to each other. We lie to each other. We lie to ourselves. We lie to God. You see, we forget who we are. You can label a fig tree an olive tree. You talked about the fig tree and the olive tree. It's not going to make it an olive tree. You can trim a fig tree to look like an olive tree. It's not an olive tree. You can treat a fig tree like an olive tree. It's not going to make it an olive tree. You can surround a fig tree with many olive trees. It won't make it an olive tree. You can transplant that fig tree to the Mount of Olives. And that's not going to make it an olive tree. Charles Spurgeon said this, unless you're regenerated, born from above, by a new and heavenly birth, you're not Christians. And whatever you may be called, you cannot produce the fruit which is acceptable to God. Any more than that fig tree can produce olive berries. All of us need to be transformed by the love and kindness and mercy of Christ. Second, do all the good you can while you can. Do all the good while you can. Christians, you ought to be. You ought to be the people everybody wants to talk to, everybody wants to hear from. And, you know, and we're not. We're not. But we need to be that way. We can disagree on things, you know, this is what God says, but listen to what God tells us to do. Proverbs 12:25. Worry weighs a person down. An encouraging word cheers a person up. Proverbs 10:19. Too much talk leads to sin. Be sensible. Keep your mouth shut. I like that one. Proverbs 16:24. Kind words are like honey, sweet to the soul and healthy for the body. People ought to love to see you coming. Even the people disagree with you, because you're the person that's going to bring encouragement and love. And then lastly, remember where the problem is. It comes out of the tongue, but it begins in the heart. Everything that James has told us and will tell us is bringing us back to the heart. That's the key to this life with God. Everyone else will look on the outside. God appreciates the outside, but he's not looking there. He's interested inside. He can see the heart. That's where it all happens. That's where it begins. And he wants our hearts to be focused on him. And you know, in Luke chapter 12, Jesus said this. He said, where your treasure is, that's where your heart is going to be. Question is, how do we get that treasure to where we focus our heart on God? Well, what are your treasures? How about your kids? Your kids are your treasures, aren't they? That's why we dedicate them to the Lord. And we say, God, I'm putting them in your care. You do what you promised. And you tell me what I need to do, and I'll keep my promises. How about your money? That's why God says, bring me the tithes and offerings. You know, that's one of the reasons we don't pass the plate here at our church, and I hope we never will. Because when you give, that's you focusing your heart by your giving to God's work here and elsewhere. How about your time? That's a treasure. Well, we're back to James telling us, have you got faith? Let me show you my faith by my works. And you know what? Those works are a gift to God of your time. You'll never get that time back again. But that's where your treasure is going to be, locked into the heart of God. What all this life is about is us trusting God enough to risk giving him the things that we treasure. And when we do, then that heart of yours will follow right into the heart of God. And then what is said in Romans, the Apostle Paul wrote, is what will be said of you. He who he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. Moreover, he predestined, these he also called. And whom he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. That's God's plan. That's what he's doing in these days and all the days of your life as you trust him. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you. You're a great and awesome God. We thank you that you're the God who knows that we struggle. We struggle with the things we say. And Father, sometimes we say things that are true, but they're hurtful. We say them the wrong way. Father, I pray that you would give us hearts that are kind and gentle and good, but Father, hearts that tell the truth. And I pray that you would help us to do that in a way that bring honor to you and peace to people. Father, that's a hard thing to do, but I pray that it begins in a heart that's given to you. And if you're not sure if your heart has been given to the Lord, or you're going, I don't even know how to do that, today is a great day to do it. And the way you do it is simply come before God and say, Lord, I want my heart to be yours. And he says, just come to me. And you come to him and say, Lord, I want you to forgive my sins, please. I agree that you've died on the cross for me. And I ask now that you would come and forgive me for all of my sin. And I'm ready to follow you as best I can. I'm going to stumble. I'm going to make mistakes and fall and do all those things. But I'll get up again and keep following. And God says, that's enough. That's what I need. And I'll bring you the very heart of God that you will know love and grace and mercy and peace. Father, thank you for that. Bless my friends now and all those they love. And we pray in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Well, that's chapter 3 of James. James, again, he always comes down and really gives us a, you know, right to the point kind of a thing. And we've got another one coming up in James chapter 4. But I want to bless you here before we let you go. And hopefully we'll get to see you next week and we'll finish out this book together in a couple of weeks. But the blessing we do right here at Quail Lake Church, and you're always welcome to come. It doesn't matter who you are, where you've been, what you've done. We want you to come here, and we'll tell you what the Bible says. And we start at 10 o'clock every Sunday morning. But I'd like you to receive this blessing. Now may the grace, mercy.
All right, let's sing How Great Is Our God. The splendor of the King. Majesty. tremble.